Good evening. Welcome to our worship on this most holy night, a time of reflection, of probably our most solemn of services. And we begin with the salutation which is printed out, "The Lord be with you." We pray, Almighty God, graciously behold this your family for whom our Lord Jesus Christ was willing to be betrayed and delivered into the hands of sinful men, to suffer death upon the cross, to the same Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. And I was told that regarding this service that the scripture readings are going to more be the preachers as far as for getting the message across concerning Good Friday. And I was told to be more short, and I could even be extemporaneous and just be able to share more of my heart with you for a few moments, and I'd like to do that. And it was just this last night I shared that my wife and I, for the first time in 20 years, had seen the movie The Passion of the Christ. This came out back in 2004. I hadn't seen it since. And I mentioned that it's really worked for me, and I think for many people, just to capture the moment and be able to understand and to be able to relate to what took place back then. And again, it's so easy with our culture, a very materialistic culture, to lose track of what Jesus did. And also, there's so much brutality in our culture, and so to be desensitized to what Jesus experienced. So the movie helped regarding that. And then it was just after the service at 11 o'clock, a lady, after I had gone through and shared what really took place to our Lord in more graphic detail, she said, "You know, I don't think we really appreciate enough concerning what Jesus did for us." And it's so easy for us, she was saying, just even the Lord's Supper, "Do this in remembrance of me," but we've done it so many times that it can be so habitual. And so there can be, we're supposed to do this in remembrance, but we can fall into the trap where there's not a lot of remembrance, but it's just kind of going through the motions kind of thing. And so this is an evening that we can more appreciate and reflect on what he did for us. And just another thing that happened, it was only a few hours ago that I went to visit a family. They want to have their young children baptized here in this church. And so I was able to talk to them for a while. I guess it was like between 4 and 5 this afternoon. And I was just asking their background, but also I wanted to know about their faith and their relationship with the Lord. And the lady said that she'd kind of fallen away. And I said, "Well, is there a personal relationship?" And she said, "Well, I'm not exactly sure." And I said, "Do you have a sense of Jesus in your life?" And she just drew a blank when I said that. And again, she wants to have her children baptized. And so I took the opportunity to share the gospel presentation, went through the law and how we've fallen short. And then I said to her, "You know, you've fallen short, I've fallen short, and the wages of sin is death." And so I said, "You know, with that in mind, is it heaven or hell?" And she was kind of taken aback. But finally she had to recognize that there would be hell, falling short of God's commands. So I said, "But here's the good news." I said, "If you're in a court of law," and I said, "if somebody pays your fine, you can just walk." And again, she began to just grasp a little bit as far as for the gospel. But when it comes to all of us who are here, when it comes to discipleship, when it comes to growing in grace and faith, I mean, that's really the start, is to learn and to appreciate. I mean, we love, we forgive because he's first loved us. But if we're not grasping that love and forgiveness, I mean, that's the motive power for our faith. That's how we grow in our fruits of faith, is through this understanding of what he has done for us. And so how precious is this time for us to be able to reflect on this and to have this opportunity to have more of a profound understanding of what our Savior has done for us. And again, through this is really what the Christian faith is all about, through our discipleship, growing in this profound understanding and then being transformed by it. And so this opportunity, again, that we have to be able to appreciate what Jesus has done for us, and just, again, considering the what took place, the brutality, the nakedness of our Lord, the humiliation that he went through, and to how allow the Holy Spirit to speak to our hearts. Greater love has no man than this, than a man lay down his life for his friends, that we might grow in this increased appreciation of this love that he has for us, to love him more and then to have the power to love and forgive others even more. So may this this be a time of a greater increased appreciation in the lives of each one of us by God's grace. Amen. And we sing.
Lesson 1, Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane. And they went to a place called Gethsemane, and he said to his disciples, "Sit here while I pray." And he took with him Peter and James and John, and began to be greatly distressed and troubled. And he said to them, "My soul is very sorrowful, even to death. Remain here and watch." And going a little farther, he fell on the ground and prayed that if it were possible, the hour might pass from him. And he said, "Abba, Father, all things are possible for you. Remove this cup from me. Yet not what I will, but what you will." And he came and found them sleeping, and he said to Peter, "Simon, are you asleep? Could you not watch 1 hour? Watch and pray that you may not enter into temptation. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak." And again he went away and prayed, saying the same words. And he came and found them sleeping, for their eyes were very heavy, and they did not know what to answer him. And he came the third time and said to them, "Are you still sleeping and taking your rest? It is enough. The hour has come. The Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Rise, let us be going. See, my betrayer is at hand." And immediately, while he was still speaking, Judas came, one of the 12, and with him a crowd with swords and clubs from the chief priests and the scribes and the elders. Now the betrayer had given them a sign, saying, "The one I will kiss is the man. Seize him and lead him away under guard." And when he came, he went up to him at once and said, "Rabbi," and he kissed him. And they laid hands on him and seized him. But one of those who stood by drew his sword and struck the servant of the high priest and cut off his ear. And Jesus said to them, "Have you come out as against a robber with swords and clubs to capture me? Day after day, I was with you in the temple teaching, and you did not seize me. But let the scriptures be fulfilled." And they all left him and fled.
A reading from Mark. And they led Jesus to the high priest, and all the chief priests and the elders and the scribes came together. And Peter had followed him at a distance, right into the courtyard of the high priest. And he was sitting with the guards and warming himself at the fire. Now the chief priests and the whole council were seeking testimony against Jesus to put him to death, but they found none. For many bore false witness against him, but their testimony did not agree. And some stood up and bore false witness against him, saying, "We heard him say, 'I will destroy this temple that is made with hands, and in 3 days I will build another, not made with hands.' Yet even about this, their testimony did not agree." And the high priest stood up in the midst and asked Jesus, "Have you no answer to make? What is it that these men testify against you?" But he remained silent and made no answer. Again, the high priest asked him, "Are you the Christ, the Son of the Blessed?" And Jesus said, "I am. And you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of power and coming with the clouds of heaven." And the high priest tore his garments and said, "What further witnesses do we need? You have heard his blasphemy. What is your decision?" And they all condemned him as deserving death. And some began to spit on him and to cover his face and to strike him, saying to him, "Prophesy." And the guards received him with blows.
Lesson 3, Peter denies Jesus. And as Peter was below in the courtyard, one of the servant girls of the high priest came, and seeing Peter warming himself, she looked at him and said, "You also were with the Nazarene, Jesus." But he denied it, saying, "I neither know nor understand what you mean." And he went out into the gateway, and the rooster crowed. And the servant girl saw him, and began again to say to the bystanders, "This man is one of them." But again, he denied it. And after a little while, the bystanders again said to Peter, "Certainly you are one of them, for you are a Galilean." But he began to invoke a curse on himself and to swear, "I do not know this man of whom you speak." And immediately the rooster crowed a second time. And Peter remembered how Jesus had said to him, "Before the rooster crows twice, you will deny me 3 times." And he broke down and wept.
Jesus' trial before Pontius Pilate. And as soon as it was morning, the chief priests held a consultation with the elders and scribes and the whole council. And they bound Jesus and led him away and delivered him over to Pilate. And Pilate asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" And he answered him, "You have said so." And the chief priests accused him of many things. And Pilate again asked him, "Have you no answer to make? See how many charges they bring against you." But Jesus made no further answer, so that Pilate was amazed. Now at the feast, he used to release for them one prisoner for whom they asked. And among the rebels in prison who had committed murder in the insurrection, there was a man called Barabbas. And the crowd came up and began to ask Pilate to do as he usually did for them. And he answered them, saying, "Do you want me to release for you the king of the Jews?" For he perceived that it was out of envy that the chief priests had delivered him up. But the chief priest stirred up the crowd to have him release for them Barabbas instead. And Pilate again said to them, "Then what shall I do with the man you call the king of the Jews?" And they cried out again, "Crucify him." And Pilate said to them, "Why? What evil has he done?" But they shouted all the more, "Crucify him." So Pilate, wishing to satisfy the crowd, released for them Barabbas, and having scourged Jesus, he delivered him to be crucified. And the soldiers led him away inside the palace, that is, the governor's headquarters, and they called together the whole battalion. And they clothed him in a purple cloak, and twisting together a crown of thorns, they put it on him. And they began to salute him, "Hail, King of the Jews!" And they were striking his head with a reed and spitting on him and kneeling down in homage to him. And when they had mocked him, they stripped him of the purple cloak and put his own clothes on him, and they led him out to crucify him.
Thank you. Mark, the 15th chapter, Jesus is crucified. And they compelled a passerby, Simon of Cyrene, who was coming in from the country, the father of Alexander and Rufus, to carry his cross. And they brought him to the place called Golgotha, which means place of a skull. And they offered him wine mixed with myrrh, but he did not take it. And they crucified him and divided his garments among them, casting lots for them to decide what each should take. And it was the third hour when they crucified him. And the inscription of the charge against him read, "The King of the Jews." And with him they crucified two robbers, one on his right and one on his left. And those who passed by derided him, wagging their heads and saying, "Aha, you who would destroy the temple and rebuild it in 3 days, save yourself and come down from the cross." So also the chief priests with the scribes mocked him to one another, saying, "He saved others, he cannot save himself. Let the Christ, the King of Israel, come down now from the cross, that we may see and believe." One of those who was crucified with him also reviled him.
We continue reading Mark 15, the death of Jesus. And when the sixth hour had come, there was darkness over the whole land until the ninth hour. And at the ninth hour, Jesus cried with a loud voice, "Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani," which means, "My God, my God, why have you forsaken me?" And some of the bystanders, hearing it, said, "Behold, he is calling Elijah." And someone ran and filled a sponge with sour wine, put it on a reed, and gave it to him to drink, saying, "Wait, let us see whether Elijah will come to take him down." And Jesus uttered a loud cry and breathed his last. And the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. And when the centurion who stood facing him saw that in this way he breathed his last, he said, "Truly, this man was the Son of God."
Thank you.
Jesus' burial, from Mark 15. And when evening had come, since it was a day of preparation, that is, the day before the Sabbath, Joseph of Arimathea, a respected member of the council, who was also himself looking for the kingdom of God, took courage and went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Pilate was surprised to hear that he should have already died. And summoning the centurion, he asked him whether he was already dead. And when he learned from the centurion that he was dead, he granted the corpse to Joseph. And Joseph bought a linen shroud, and taking him down, wrapped him in the linen shroud and laid him in a tomb that had been cut out of the rock. And he rolled a stone against the entrance of the tomb. Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of Joseph, saw where he was laid. It is finished.